what is self-supervised learning? And maybe even give the bigger basics of what is supervised and semi-supervised learning. And maybe why is self-supervised learning a better term than unsupervised learning?
Let's start with supervised learning. So typically for machine learning systems, the way they're trained is you get a bunch of humans. The humans point out particular concepts. So if it's in the case of images, you want the humans to come and tell you what is present in the image, draw boxes around them, draw masks of like things, pixels, which are of particular categories or not. For NLP, again, there are like lots of these particular tasks, say about sentiment analysis, about entailment and so on. So typically for supervised learning, we get a big corpus of such annotated or labeled data, and then we feed that to a system, and the system is really trying to mimic. So it's taking this input of the data and then trying to mimic the output. So it looks at an image and the human has tagged that this image contains a banana. And now the system is basically trying to mimic that. So that's its learning signal. And so for supervised learning, we try to gather lots of such data and we train these machine learning models to imitate the input or output. And the hope is basically by doing so, now on unseen or like new kinds of data, this model can automatically learn to predict these concepts. So this is a standard sort of supervised setting. For semi-supervised setting, the idea typically is that you have, of course, all of the supervised data, but you have lots of other data which is unsupervised or which is like not labeled. Now, the problem basically with supervised learning and why you actually have all of these alternate sort of learning paradigms is supervised learning does not scale. So if you look at for computer vision, the sort of largest, one of the most popular data sets is ImageNet, right? So the entire ImageNet data set has about 22,000 concepts and about 14 million images. So these concepts are basically just nouns and they're annotated on images. And this entire data set was a mammoth data collection effort. It actually gave rise to a lot of powerful learning algorithms. It's credited with like sort of the rise of deep learning as well. But this data set took about 22 human years to collect, to annotate. And it's not even that many concepts, right? It's not even that many images. 14 million is nothing, really. Like you have about, I think, 400 million images or so, or even more than that uploaded to most of the popular sort of social media websites today. So now supervised learning just doesn't scale. If I want to now annotate more concepts, if I want to have various types of fine-grained concepts, then it won't really scale. So now you come up to these sort of different learning paradigms, for example, semi-supervised learning, where the idea is, you have this annotated corpus of supervised data, and you have lots of these unlabeled images. And the idea is that the algorithm should basically try to measure some kind of consistency or really try to measure some kind of signal on this sort of unlabeled data to make itself more confident about what it's really trying to predict. So by access to this lots of unlabeled data, the idea is that the algorithm actually learns to be more confident and actually gets better at predicting these concepts. And now we come to the other extreme, which is like self-supervised learning. The idea basically is that the machine or the algorithm should really discover concepts or discover things about the world or learn representations about the world which are useful without access to explicit human supervision.
So the word supervision is still in the term self-supervised. So what is the supervision signal? And maybe that perhaps is when Jan LeCun and you argue that unsupervised is the incorrect terminology here. So what is the supervision signal when the humans aren't part of the picture or not? A big part of the picture.
Right. So self-supervised, the reason it has the term supervised in itself is because you're using the data itself as supervision. So because the data serves as its own source of supervision, it's self-supervised in that way. Now, the reason a lot of people, I mean, we did it in that blog post with Jan, but a lot of other people have also argued for using this term self-supervised. So starting from like 94 from Virginia Desai's group at, I think, UCSD. And now she's at UCSD. Jitendra Malik has said this a bunch of times as well. So you have supervised, and then unsupervised basically means everything which is not supervised. But that includes stuff like semi-supervised, that includes other like transductive learning, lots of other sort of settings. So that's the reason like now people are preferring this term self-supervised because it explicitly says what's happening. The data itself is the source of supervision, and any sort of learning algorithm which tries to extract just sort of data supervision signals from the data itself is a self-supervised learning algorithm.
But there is within the data a set of tricks which unlock the supervision.
Right.
So can you give maybe some examples? And there's innovation, ingenuity required to unlock that supervision.
Right.
The data doesn't just speak to you some ground truth. You have to do some kind of trick.
Right.
So I don't know what your favorite domain is. So you specifically specialize in visual learning, but is there favorite examples maybe in language or other domains?
Perhaps the most successful applications have been in NLP, not language processing. So the idea basically being that you can train models that can, you have a sentence and you mask out certain words. And now these models learn to predict the masked out words. So if you have like the cat jumped over the dog, so you can basically mask out cat. And now you're essentially asking the model to predict what was missing, what did I mask out? So the model is going to predict basically a distribution over all the possible words that it knows. And probably it has, like, if it's a well-trained model, it has a sort of high probability density for this word cat. For vision, I would say the sort of more, the easier example, which is not as widely used these days, is basically, say, for example, video prediction. So video is, again, a sequence of things. So you can ask the model, so if you have a video of, say, 10 seconds, you can feed in the first 9 seconds to a model and then ask it, hey, what happens basically in the 10 second? Can you predict what's going to happen? And the idea basically is because the model is predicting something about the data itself. Of course, you didn't need any human to tell you what was happening because the 10 second video was naturally captured. Because the model is predicting what's happening there, it's going to automatically learn something about the structure of the world, how objects move, object permanence, and these kinds of things. So like if I have something at the edge of the table, it'll fall down. Things like these, which you really don't have to sit and annotate. In a supervised learning setting, I would have to sit and annotate. This is a cup. Now I move this cup. This is still a cup. And now I move this cup. It's still a cup. And then it falls down. And this is a fallen down cup. So I won't have to annotate all of these things in a self-supervised setting.
Isn't that kind of a brilliant little trick of taking a series of data that is consistent and removing one element in that series and then teaching the algorithm to predict that element? Isn't that, first of all, that's quite brilliant. It seems to be applicable in anything that has the constraint of being a sequence that is consistent with the physical reality. The question is, are there other tricks like this that can generate the self-supervision signal?
So sequence is possibly the most widely used one in NLP. For vision, the one that is actually used for like images, which is very popular these days, is basically taking an image and now taking different crops of that image. So you can basically decide to crop, say, the top left corner and you crop, say, the bottom right corner and asking a network to basically present it with a choice, saying that, okay, now you have this image, you have this image. Are these the same or not? And so the idea basically is that because different, like in an image, different parts of the image are going to be related. So for example, if you have a chair and a table, basically these things are going to be close by. Versus if you take, again, if you have like a zoomed in picture of a chair, if you take in different crops, it's going to be different parts of the chair. So the idea basically is that different crops of the image are related. And so the features or the representations that you get from these different crops should also be related. So this is possibly the most like widely used trick these days for self-supervised learning in computer vision.
So again, using the consistency that's inherent to physical reality in visual domain, that's, you know, parts of an image are consistent. And then in the language domain or anything that has sequences like language or something that's like a time series, then you can chop off parts in time. Right. It's similar to the story of RNNs and CNNs, of RNNs and convnets.